In this video, we're continuing to build out our Rails app, Doable, a little productivity tool where users can create projects and to-dos. And right now, we can create a to-do, we can create a project, but the two don't really know anything about each other. So today, we're gonna connect these two things. We'll make it so that every to-do belongs to a specific project, and we'll walk through the whole process, updating our database, wiring up our models, updating our forms and views, and then seeing it all in action. So let's do it. Or should I say, let's to-do it. Dad jokes, am I right? Okay, so starting off, when one object belongs to another, it needs to store a reference. In our case, a to-do needs to belong to a project, so the to-do table in our application needs to have a project ID column. So let's go ahead and create a migration to add the project ID column to our to-dos table. Let's go to our terminal and type bin rails generate migration, add project ID to to-dos. And then we type project colon references. Now we hit enter. You see, this creates a project ID column on the to-dos table, and Rails will also set up a foreign key constraint. Let's go check out this migration. We can go to our migrations files and check that we have, yes, we're adding a reference on the to-dos table for project. This is not nullable in our database. We covered this before in the previous video, and the foreign key is set to true. So this is the general rule in Rails. The table that belongs holds the foreign key. It's also why we use the name project underscore ID. Rails expects that. And this is all part of Rails's convention over configuration philosophy. You can override these defaults if you want, but if you follow the naming rules, everything will just work the way it's supposed to. And in this table, we can see that we want to require every to-do belongs to a project, so we add null false. So now our project ID column is not nullable. Also, by default, we set the project ID as the foreign key for the reference to project on the to-dos table. But wait, this presents a little bit of a problem. If we already have to-dos in our database, which we do, this will break because those rows don't actually have a project ID yet. Thankfully though, this is early on in our project and we're in dev mode, so it's safe to just reset our database and start clean. So we could just run bin rails db drop db create and db migrate. Okay, there we go. Now every to-do has a project ID column on it, and we can now connect our to-dos to our projects. Pretty cool. So now let's go into our application and update our models to reflect this new relationship. We can go to our to-do model in app models, and we can type belongs underscore to project. And in our projects model, we can type has many to-dos dependent destroy. This will set up the relationship in both directions. Every to-do now belongs to one project, and every project can have many to-dos. This dependent destroy line here is important as well. It means that when a project is deleted, all of its associated to-dos get deleted as well. Without that, you might have leftover to-dos that don't belong to anything, like a to-do that says add dark mode or something, but the project for it no longer exists. We don't want that in our application, so we want to make sure that we destroy every to-do when a project gets destroyed. Okay, now let's go into our Rails console really quick and play around with this concept. Let's create a new project with a name. Let's say plan a vacation. Okay, great. So now we have a new project and we want to set the project variable to the last thing we just ran, that is underscore. And now we have project as the project that we just created. Great. Now we can create a new to-do. So to-do.create. And in this to-do, we want a name called, let's say, book a flight. Now within this to-do, I want to set a project. So I can just type project. Project. Or you can get a little fancy and use our newer Ruby syntax here. And if the name of the attribute matches the name of the key you're passing in, you can just omit the attribute itself. So we are creating a new to-do and we are setting project to the project we just created. So now this creates a new to-do in our project. And these relationships give us certain methods. So I could say, first of all, let me just set the to-do to what we just created there. I could say to-do.project and that gives me the project. And I could say project.todos because a project project has many to-dos, and there we go. That gives us back the to-dos for that project. Okay, great, so now these relationships are up and running and working as expected. That's pretty cool. Let's move forward. So now let's add the ability for someone when they're creating a new to-do in our application to select a project to associate it to. Cool, let's do that now. We're gonna wanna change the form of the to-do. So let's go ahead and open up the underscore form for our to-do directory. This was created for us by scaffolding. As you remember, we actually made this manually as well for our projects, but the scaffold is extremely similar to what we created. Let's just go down here a little bit and let's just add a couple more things. First of all, we want to add one of the attributes that we added to our to-dos, and that is the completed attribute. And this is not a text area. This is actually a checkbox because it's a Boolean. And the checkbox is for the completed attribute. Very good. Next, we're gonna wanna add the other attribute that we added in our previous video to our to-do model, and that is the priority. We want to add priority, and it is a integer, so this is actually a number underscore field, and we add priority. Cool. And last but not least, we actually want to add a way for a user to associate this to-do to a project. So let's go ahead and do that now. We can just copy this div right here, paste it below. This form.label will be our project ID. That is the thing that we are going to be associating. And we want to have in our form helper here, this is going to be a collection select. And we are going to be selecting a project underscore ID. And our collection is project.all ID and name. The ID and name pieces actually tell us in the project association we get back from our collection, what attributes are we using? The ID is going to be the project ID. That'll be the value of our select box. And the name will actually be what we display to the user. And then our prompt for this select box will be select a project. Okay, great. This looks good to me. So now let's go back and check out our form for a new to-do. Okay, cool. Working great. So again, this code snippet here adds all the new fields we introduced from our last video, plus a dropdown to associate the to-do with a project. These are all form helpers, and the collection select helper generates a dropdown, which is a select element in a Rails form for choosing a project ID using all of the project records. It then displays each project's name as the visible option and submits the selected project's ID. It also includes the select object prompt at the top. Now we can actually go to our view here. We can right click on this dropdown, click on inspect, and we can see that this is a select element and each selection has the value of the project's ID, and the thing we display to the end user is the name of the project. That is how Rails builds this form with this helper. And speaking of helpers, all of these helpers, form.label, form.checkbox, they come from a part of Rails called ActionViewHelpers.form builder. The ActionView Helpers Form Builder library gives you a ton of useful methods that generate HTML forms and automatically link them to your models. So if you're curious if there are any other form helpers you can use here other than the ones you see in this video, check out the documentation here. It's full of interesting ideas. Okay, so now let's go ahead and try our form. We want to create a new to-do. Let's just call this one example. This is a description example. We want to make this completed. We want to set the priority to 2 and we want to select the project as planned vacation. Let's create the to-do. Interesting. Why did this not work? It seems like it's saying the project must exist, but I just selected a project. What happened here? Well, you see, this validation actually gives us a little bit of a clue as to what's happening. You see, we updated our models and we updated this form, but we didn't update our controller. You see, what's happening is we forgot to add these fields to our strong parameters. So let's go to our to-dos controller and add those in. You can see at the bottom here, we have to-do params, and this is params.expect to-do with name and description only. So we're gonna wanna add the rest of the stuff in here. So let's go ahead and add the completed Boolean. We also want to add the priority that we just added in our previous episode, and now we want to add our project ID. There, so now all of our parameters are going to be allowed in this controller. This is why strong parameters are great. You can only allow certain parameters through, and we filtered out the ones that we didn't actually know about yet. Okay, so now let's try our form again and see if this works. We can select a project, we can click on completed, and our priority is gonna be 2. Okay, awesome. Now this to-do was successfully created. Fantastic. Okay, now that we're here in this view for our to-do, we can see that we actually don't have all of the information for our to-do. We don't know about the project, the priority, or the completed status. So let's go ahead and update that view now. We can go to our to-do show view, and we can scroll down here and see that it actually calls render to do. Now, this is another convention in Rails. When you pass a model to render in a view like this, Rails knows that you're trying to render a partial called underscore to do, and we're passing in to do as the name of the variable. So we can now go to our underscore todo.html.erb, and this is the partial for our to do. Pretty cool, right? Conventions are amazing. It makes developing so straightforward. So let's just go ahead and we can copy this p tag, and let's just add three new instances of it right here. Let's delete some of our extra lines. And we have a few new attributes that we want to add here. This is the completed attribute, and we want to make this todo.completed. Then we also have the priority of our todo that we added. We want to add todo.priority. And then at the very end here, we actually want to add a project. So let's type project, and this is going to be a link to the project for this to do. So let's call link underscore to project underscore path. And if you remember before, when we link to a project path, we want to pass in the ID. Now the to do has the project available to it. So we can pass to do.project to the project path. And we want to name this link, before I forget, todo.project.name. See, todo already has all the information for the project because it is related. Now we can write this file. Now if we go back to our view, we see we have all this information here plus a link to our project. We can click on plan a vacation and it goes to our project's show view. How awesome is that? But if you're a keen observer here, which I know you are, aren't you? Then you may have noticed that since we have a project here, our project has many to-dos, but we're not really displaying them on the project show view. So let's go ahead and change that. So now we can go to our project show view, and inside of our show view, we want to add a little more information. So let's delete this project details coming soon part. We want to add a new list to this view. And what we want to do here is we want to loop over all of our project dot to-dos dot each. We want to do to-do. This will set the variable for each item that we're looping over. We want to end this looping just like that. And for each to-do, we want to create a new list item. And within that list item, we want to then display the to-do dot name. And let's do something a little bit fun here. We can say if to-do dot completed, we can display a check mark. That's fun, right? Sure. Now, if we go back to our page, we can see that, okay, this is great. We actually have two to-dos. And I remember now I created a to-do for this project in the console earlier. So that's where this Book of Flight one came from. And then the example one I actually created from the to-do form just a minute ago. Okay, this is really cool. But you know what? I think I actually want to make these links. So I'm just going to go ahead and change this to link underscore to to-do.name. I want to link to the to-do path. I want to pass in the to-do as the argument, and that should be it. Now, if I hit refresh, I link back to our to-do, and I can click on plan a vacation, the project. I link back to our project. This is awesome. This is amazing. Our app is feeling really great now. So in this video, we built a real relationship between our projects and to-dos. They are now finally together like they were always meant to be. Isn't that wonderful? We did this by adding a foreign key. We connected our models. We updated the forms and views, and we debugged a strong params issue. And along the way, we made our app feel way more connected and way more usable. I mean, you can see it right here. It's so fun to now just click around between a to-do, between the project. It's awesome. So now when you view a project, you see the to-dos that go with it, you know what project it belongs to, and all of that comes from just a few lines of well-placed code. I mean, this is all it takes. It's really just that easy with Rails. So now in the next video, we're going to take this solid functionality and start to make it look really good. We're going to bring in Tailwind CSS to clean up the UI and give our app a little bit more polish. Because a great user experience isn't just about what your app does, it's about how it feels to use it. And looking good doesn't hurt. Am I right? So if you're ready to make this thing feel like a real product, I'm gonna show you how to get there. We're adding Tailwind CSS in the next episode, so check that one out. And hey, thanks, nerds.